Well, good. Well, and good evening, everyone. And it's so awesome to have y'all all here. And I think everyone knows everyone here, right? Everyone knows everyone in this group, so we don't gotta do intros or anything. And so I am really excited that we're having this course called the Disabled God. It's our first session of five for our Easter Evensong series. I think up until personally for me, up until the last couple of years, this wasn't an issue I thought about at all. And in fact, I was probably pretty regressive on, a pretty big jerk on. All right, I'm always zipping around fast, and I want people to get out of my way, and like you know, and all there's so much, initially when people were talking about wanting to put in a lift into our sanctuary, I was like, oh, that's gonna take so much work to get there. I don't know if that should be the priority. And I was so wrong. I think in so many ways. Fundamentally, I think the number one value we have at Messiah Lutheran Church is being a welcoming and inviting congregation. And what could be a more important way of signaling that than letting everyone, no matter their ability, be able to eat with us in the fellowship hall, be able to use the restroom. And so I think this is such an important issue to take a little bit more of a look at. And we're going to be covering a bunch of different topics over the next 5 weeks. This is sort of our intro night and with a little bit of history. And but most importantly, I'm just so stoked to be co-leading this class with Hannah. Want to say hi,
Hi. Oh my
Hannah?
God. Okay, it is.
Very good. Yeah, and I'll tell you, it's been a Hannah was in my first confirmation class here at Messiah, what, 7 years ago now or so? 8 years ago?
Probably.
Yeah.
What is confirmation normally? I don't even remember. It was before I had a driver's license, so it had to be.
Oh yeah, you were in middle school. Yeah. So.
You're right. I think it's like eighth and ninth grade. So, and
Yep.
I'm now a junior in college.
Yeah.
So
And
enjoy that.
Hannah was our one youth who went to the National Youth Gathering last time around in Houston, and so we got to bond then too. And it's amazing how yeah, she's just grown into a really wonderful faith-inspired activist in so many ways, and especially around these issues of disability. And yeah, I'm just really thankful for her being here. I'm gonna do my best to, because I'm in everything. It's always a nice thing if you are in all these sort of learning experiences. If you're someone who tends to chat a lot, it's always nice to step back and listen. And if you're someone who's a little bit quieter, there's always an invitation to sort of, we really want to, hear your perspective. And I'm someone that always talks a lot. And so I'm going to try to step back and especially let Hannah lead some of these sessions. So the way that all these will work, and I'm sorry, this I don't have a syllabus for you quite yet, but you will be getting an email by tomorrow with that syllabus. There was a few tweaks that I wanted to make to what we had planned out. So today we're going to talk, just do some intro stuff and talk about some history. And we'll start each session with a little short Bible study, very similar format to the previous courses I've led recently. Next course, we're going to talk about really dig a little more deeper into different themes in the Bible and how it can be both there's obviously some really significant ableism in the Bible, and also there's sources of liberation for people with disabilities in the Bible. So we're going to be doing more of the scriptures next time. Two classes out, we're going to be doing the history of people with disabilities and the church specifically, and it's not a pretty history, like at all. To the to name that. Our fourth class, we're going to do disability rights on sort of the global level, because it certainly plays out in other countries in a very different way than the United States. And then the last course, we're going to talk a little bit more about inclusive language and probably ground a little bit more in Messiah's experience and sort of look at some models of success and and figure out how we can continue to improve on our way forward. And, you know, and that'll be right, you know, a few days before we have our groundbreaking on our new accessible entrance. So that's kind of the shape of things. I'm wondering if I know everyone knows everyone a little bit, but just so we can make sure that we're sort of talking about all the things that you want, you know, you want to learn about. If we could just go around and say maybe our name and, you know, what interest especially, you know, what's a question or what's a topic especially you bring into, you know, wanting to be addressed in the, in these conversations. So I'll start and then I'll, you know, I'll see. I'll, Pete, you can go next. How about that? You're the next box over for me. So I think for me, you know, there's, I've been trying to read a lot and learn a lot. But I'm just so thankful for the opportunity to have some more conversation with Hanna about some lived experience and also to start identifying there are so many gaps, in terms of what we, you know, what we can, we have in our congregation, even once we do have a lift, right. And to start figuring out what those things are, I think is just really, important. So that's an area that I'm really interested in.
Okay. Well, I'm Pete, and I think, you know, we have a disabled son and a disabled grandson. And so we have been, working with disabled people for many years. One of our other children is dyslexic. So I'm always looking to learn something new. And, you know, I watch people try to get up and down the stairs, you know, people with canes, people with bad knees like me, and we have to crawl up the stairs. So having that elevator will be wonderful. Carly, you get to be next.
Okay, I'm Carly, and I'm just anxious to learn as much as I can on the topic. Croaching 77, I think that, you know, as Pete mentioned, disability going up and down stairs and just navigating is becoming a little bit more problematic than it was when I was younger. So I'm anxious to just learn more about it. Oh, Jean.
Hi, I'm Jean. And as Pete said, we have two children who have disabilities, and it's been a real struggle during over the years with the school, and their disabilities are not physical; they're more intellectual, and it's really been a problem at school working through the maze of IEPs and all of the systems that are in place to help people with disabilities that don't always work the way they're supposed to. They have made some progress, but there's still a lot to be done. And now with our son, I'm working through this maze of working with an agency, working with a care manager, working with all kinds of financial implications that go into it to keep him in a residence or in a house where, you know, he's safe. So I'd like to, you know, gain some more knowledge about that, if that's possible.
You know, I appreciate that, Jean. So when we were talking about this course a couple of days ago, Jean, Hanna and I we couldn't remember what one of the week's topics we wanted it to be. Remember that, Hanna?
Yeah.
Now that we're talking about this, I'm remembering that, and I think we might want to tweak that day where we do the just talk about global issues, because we wanted to spend one day at least specifically on intellectual disabilities. That was what that topic's day other day was that we couldn't figure out what we had originally talked about.
Yeah.
So let's make sure we have that as a specific thing. So for sure.
For sure. Yes.
So that's really super huge. Hanna, Rianne, or whoever wants to go.
I can go. Yeah. Sorry. I'm Hanna. You have to bear with me. I woke up yesterday morning with a cold, and I've had about 6 COVID tests in the past 24 hours, but they're all negative. But anyway, so I am a 21-year-old disabled college student, and all 4 of my siblings also live with disability. And I have personally have found myself really intrigued by different personal stories and different experiences and how they differ from one another. So my personal interest a lot, especially in getting to dive into in this course, is kind of other people's experiences and other people's like understandings, because I feel like that's one of the best ways that we can dive into topics like this, is to be able to listen to each other and understand where each point is coming from, because it really is such a complex topic. And even within the disability community itself, there's a lot of controversy. So it's a really cool topic to be able to talk about. And I'm really excited to talk about it with you guys.
Awesome. Cool. Thanks, Hanna. Ann?
Oh, I forgot you were even doing this. I got the email. I'm like, oh, this is cool. So yeah, I messed up my back quite a while ago. So I have a mobility issue. I also have mental stuff going on, so that's a disability too, and it's lovely navigating in a not so lovely way in a not so lovely world. I don't know, I'm just in for the ride and seeing what's going to happen and listen in whenever I can.
Awesome. Cool. Well, let's say a quick prayer, and then we'll briefly touch on a Bible verse, and then Hanna will take over here. So let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the opportunity to be together, to talk about such an important topic, too, especially as we're about ready to break ground on to make our building fully accessible for all your children, to really think about, you know, all the implications of that and why it's so important and how it interacts with the history of the church and our calling as Christians and the scriptures and all the different ways that we live into your call to be one body in Christ across all our diversities and experiences. We give you thanks for everyone who's joining us. We give you thanks for Hanna's leadership tonight and in the coming weeks. And we say all these things in the name of your son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. All right. So what I thought for an initial scripture reading, one thing that is really helpful when we talk about any sort of social issue, as if you saw my post about the Roe v. Wade stuff yesterday, as Lutherans, we have these ELCA social statements and social messages, and a lot of them are really good starting points. Some could use some improvement, but we do have a social message about disability rights and people with disabilities, and that was written in it's a social message, so it's not quite as big deal as a social statement, but it's an important topic, this was written in 2011. And it really grounds a lot of what what's being talked about here in 2 different Bible verses. Everything is grounded in sort of these 2 Bible verses. So I thought we could start by just looking at those 2 Bible verses as at least what our church kind of puts forward as starting points for thinking about this issue. So I had one. Let me pull up the other one. Cool. All right. So let's start with Genesis. You've probably heard this one before. I name it, all the time. I think for me, it's a central concept of my theology in general. But I'll read it for folks from Genesis 1:26-27 and. Now Bible Gateway uses the updated edition of the NRSV, so that's fun. Then God said, "Let us make humans in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have the dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humans in his image. in the image of God. He created them, male and female, he created them. So, you know, when it comes to thinking about care for creation, I know some of us have talked about this topic recently. This isn't the best text in some ways, in that it really kind of separates out humanity from the rest of God's creation in perhaps an unhelpful way. But it also provides, you know, a really important, probably a central concept in Christian theology called the in Latin imago Dei, the image of God. Right, and that is the idea. There is that, right? Every single person, because of who they are, every single person is a reflection of God's image, and God's image is reflected in them. So, when we relate, so right. And so what a lot of different groups, especially different groups that have been marginalized or oppressed in some way, when they've looked at the scriptures and they've tried to find sources of hope and inspiration, it's a fairly typical thing to say, well, okay, so someone like me, who society has in a different, in whatever way pushed down, I'm created in the image of God too, right? And so, so that's a big concept for, so, right, a book that it's a little bit heavy, but not that much, that I found helpful in preparing for this course was called The Disabled God, Towards Liberation Theology of Disability, right? The idea here is written by someone named Nancy Iceland, who, you know, had, you know, really a long-term disability. Herself, and the idea here is that my experience, my body is as divine as, or is as reflective of the divine as anyone's, right? So I think that's an important thing to note. Any conversation about that or thoughts about that text? I feel like it's kind of a straightforward concept. I don't know. So, and then the other text that that Lutheran teaching really kind of grounds itself on is this one. Colossians 1, 15 to 20. And this is one of my favorite texts in the whole Bible. He is so it expounds on that idea of the image of God in the New Testament, right? He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of creation, for in him all things in heaven and on earth were created. Things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers, all things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything, for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile himself to all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. So there you have this idea of like God's reflected in everything, right? In our bodies, no matter their ability. God, you know, Jesus himself, right, is, you know, presents himself as you know, following the crucifixion and resurrection, as disabled in some way, right? You know, so and so there's this idea that there too, you know, everyone's life, and really all of, and then here it gets a little more to all of creation, right, is a reflection of God's image. And then B is somehow all intricately related together, too, all connected in Christ. You know, that those are the two texts that sort of the ELCA's social message. That's their starting point. So, yeah, I don't know. Any more thoughts about either of those concepts or questions? Or you can also just get by the boring Bible stuff and go straight to Hanna, whatever you want. Yeah. next week we're gonna when we talk about more scripture, we're gonna deal with there's a lot of problematic texts, and what do we do with those in the scriptures too. So Hanna, the floor is yours.
Okay. So it was actually really interesting getting asked to do this, because what sparked it was a conversation with a pastor probably about 2 months ago now, with some issues on my own personal college campus that we were having with the administration and their use of incredibly inappropriate language. And it just brings up these really interesting conversations about, like, you know, what's okay, what's not. They were using some incredibly archaic language, and they were using some texts that were a little bit like about the view of disabled people. And he was like, would you want to help teach us? And I was like, I'm your girl. But it's also finals week, and I think my brain is about a million places at once right now, so I do apologize in advance. But anyway, moving on, Pastor thought it would be really good. He made a really good point that a lot of people learn best when you're talking about people's personal experiences and being able to dive into personal experiences. And I feel like a lot of people know me. I haven't been around very often anymore because now I'm away at college. But like, I've been a member of Messiah for the past 10 years, and like watching my evolution as a young adult and my health has been kind of a really tricky concept. About like going back to Messiah for the first time this past summer with Aster was probably one of the hardest things to do, because I feel like a lot of people have a really hard time seeing the girl I am now versus the girl I was when I was running cross country and track and running 6K races all of the time. And now I can't get up and down the stairs without help. but anyway, so I thought it'd be really great to kind of really formally introduce myself and a little bit of my spiel and what exactly I do. So I'm a third year student at Houghton College. If you don't know where that is, it's west southern tier New York. It's in the sticks. There's a cornfield across the street. That's about it. That's where I go to college. So it's right in the brink of southern western New York, and we have a lot of cows and corn here. That's it. The best kind of descriptor is like SUNY Geneseo, Alfred State, right around that area. But anyway, I am an equine management and communications double majors. So I actually study horses and people at the same time, which is really interesting. My personal interests are communications and marketing and social media, digital marketing type stuff. And I'm hoping to work within the equine industry doing that. But I also really, really love people a lot. And over the past like 4 years, I've become a significantly more confident like public speaker, and found that I really enjoy speaking out on social media. I run several social media accounts personally where I speak out about these issues, and I educate people on my service dog and things like that. So essentially, I have a mobility impairment, and I have some other health issues going on. I was born with a neurological condition called spina bifida occulta, which means I basically have a small hole in my spine. And we didn't discover it until I was about 12, 13, 14. It was before high school. But initially, I didn't really have a ton of nerve damage from it, other than some small like details about my health where I struggled with neurologically. But my freshman year of college, about 2 months into my freshman semester here at Houghton, I was involved in a car wreck, and I damaged my lumbar spine even further. And now I am considered to have paraparesis or a paraparetic. So I actually have almost no feeling below my knees anymore. And I have some balance issues going on, and I do have a little bit of trouble walking. I have a service dog, and I'm a part-time mobility aid user. Aster is currently snoring at the foot of my bed right now. She's a big hunky black lab. She'll be making an appearance in May, because we are coming for a few weeks before I go to my internship. And then I also am a grade 5 para dressage rider. So I do ride horses competitively using adaptations and accommodations in my riding, which is really fun, really exciting to get to teach people about adaptive athletics. But I do no longer run cross country, but I do ride horses pretty much full time now. I think I spent about 15 hours in the saddle this past week alone. So, but yeah, and a lot of it is that I found I have enjoyed really talking about this stuff, and people are always asking me questions, and a lot of people are like, you know, why do you open up on social media about like the nitty-gritty details of your health? And I'm like, well, because I got a DM from a little girl told me that I made her feel less alone, or I got a question from a stranger halfway across the world where they were genuinely curious about something and they wanted to improve their language and how they approach conversations like this. I have people who have never heard of a real service dog in their life, and they're like, what the heck does she do? And I'm like, her job is to keep me from hitting the floor. That's quite literally her job description. And her tail's wagging while she does it. But yeah, she's a balance assistant service dog. But yeah, that's kind of a little bit about me and where I am in my life right now. And I am currently a panelist on my college's accessibility panel, a student with Students with Disabilities Accessibility Panel, where I have led conversations here on campus about it, because it's becoming a bigger conversation here on my college campus now that the only dorm building that has an elevator is now being closed to the women. People are like, well, what happens if you have a female student in a wheelchair? And they have a female student in a wheelchair coming next year. And they're like, huh, now what? So it's kind of like the same conversations there at church. Like, we have these situations where people can't get up and down the stairs, and you're like, no, now what? So I've been heavily involved in some of those conversations about how we can make this female student feel as welcome and included on campus and in dorm life when we're still struggling with the infrastructure of our campus, which is very old. And yeah, that's most of it. So I'm pretty actively involved in these conversations all of the time, and have had several conversations with Pastor about it. And I'm really, really happy to be here. And tonight I'm kind of just gonna try not to run over and talk a little bit about some of the brief history of the disability rights movement itself, and some of the kind of like a brief overview of the kind of like topic itself and accessibility, ableism, and all that. But before I dove in, I wanted to open the floor if anybody had questions, comments, quips, a joke, I don't know, talk before, because I also like to talk, and I love to have conversations. I don't like to just speak. So I do want people to feel like if they have a question or a comment, they can just interject. It's not rude. I also can be like Pastor, where I will talk forever. So never hesitate to, yeah, he's nodding. Never hesitate to be like, oh, I have a question, or can you clarify something a little bit more about that? And I would be super happy to do so. But yeah, if anybody has any questions or comments before we really get into the boring, not boring, anyway, Pete.
I think it's interesting that you're involved with equestrian, studying equestrian, because Tyler goes to the Albany Therapeutic,
I almost did an internship there this summer, actually. But I'm actually going to a therapeutic riding center in Colorado this summer instead. But yeah, therapeutic riding versus para riding is a little bit different, but therapeutic horsemanship has become a widely increasingly popular topic for disability, both intellectual, mental, physical. It's used a lot with at-risk youth or high-risk youth, like flight risks or juveniles who are in situations where they may be homeless or in foster care and things like that. It's also become increasingly popular just for youth programs, and just the concept of how horses can be used incredibly therapeutically. Now, don't let me talk about this for half an hour. You're going to get me going. But but yeah, no, therapeutic horsemanship is a really fascinating topic. So I'm not particularly going into the field of therapeutic horsemanship. I'm particularly going into competitive equestrian event. But therapeutic horsemanship, like, I'm really excited to get Lydia a little bit more involved with it this summer. And they were really excited to hear that I was going to be joining their team for the summer because of my personal situation that I have Aster. And they're like, this is going to be great for the kids to be able to see someone out here and doing a job more than just having sidewalkers and people who learned about disability a week before they started volunteering at the center. But yeah, I actually almost interned there. Therapeutic horsemanship is fantastic. And I almost minored in it. We have a therapeutic horsemanship minor at my college because we have a herd of 36 horses here. that we learn and teach with. So, but yeah, I am more along the lines of, I'm not looking to get into like Paralympic riding, but like I'm more along the lines of like competing and being like athletically involved using adaptations and less so of the using horsemanship of as a form of therapeutic or medicine. Anyone else?
Well, I just wanted to thank you, Hanna, for sharing your story with us, because we knew you before your accident and when you had your accident, and haven't seen you since then really a lot. So I didn't really, you know, I don't know what has been going on in your life. So thank you for letting us know.
Of course. I am an absolute open book. And my nearly 90,000 followers on TikTok are really here for it. But anyway, yeah, so if nobody else has anything else to say, I'm going to jump right in so I don't keep you guys past the time that I was told we're supposed to be over. So, all right. Okay. So kind of jumping right in, I always like to start these conversations with a discussion of the different types of disability models and how each one played a role in history. And there are three most well-known types of models that describe disability. And each one has its place in history. The first one is known as the moral model. And this is the model that is generally most associated with religion because it is deeply rooted in a lot of conservative and more traditional religious practices. And that's the idea that like disability is the result of a sin, or people with disabilities are disabled because they were given a trial and tribulation because they knew that they could take it. Or it was kind of like a moral status because this person is like helpless, and it gave people like a moral, like we need to help this person. It's actually a really fascinating model, and it still exists a lot today, especially within a lot of churches and religions like across the board and across the world. The second model is the probably the one that is most well known and what people generally most associate with disability. And that is the medical model. And that is the idea that like disability is a sickness or an illness or something that needs to be cured or something that needs to be fixed. And that's deeply rooted a lot in like the 1800s all the way up until now. There's still a lot of like push for like curing disability or curing variety of different health issues when some of them that shouldn't be the focus for some of them. And then finally, the social model, which is the one that a lot of people are pushing now and is most generally associated with disability activism, is the social model. Anyway, social model is kind of the concept that you are not disabled by your body, you're disabled by the world around you and inaccessibility itself. And we see this a lot with intellectual disability and developmental disability like autism, especially. Where the idea that I'm going to use autistics as my example because this is something I'm very familiar with. You guys all know Kyle. He is autistic. And kind of like the idea that like autism itself is not what's wrong with the person. It's the fact that people aren't willing to accommodate and learn and make the autistic feel included is what's creating autism as a disability. I think it's a really fascinating topic. And they're still within like disability conversation itself. Well, do you follow the medical model? Do you follow the social model? The moral model has kind of been thrown out the window for most of us now at this point. But no, it's really interesting. And so yeah, so I'm gonna talk a lot about the movement itself. And the movement itself started right around the same time as the civil rights movement. But just like the civil rights movement, there's also a long history that goes before. And I could bore you guys for hours about the 1800s. And institutionalization, but I am just going to touch very briefly on some of the like moments in history and how it developed into what is now what we have now and activism today. So I am going to start right down back to Dorothy Dix. Dorothy Dix is a well-known nurse, and she is the person who advocated for the asylums that were created in the 1800s. And at the time, it was supposed to be an opportunity to help disabled people live independently and give them a place where they can live and get the care that they needed. But it very quickly turned into an abusive system. And a lot of people were institutionalized because of the idea of the moral model where they needed to be helped and or that they were a product of sin. And it created a lot of fear within society itself that these disabled people were quite literally like unacceptable in society. So a lot of them, especially intellectual disabilities, were institutionalized because of fear of disability. Quite literally, people were scared of disability itself back then. And that eventually kind of moved into what would be known as the eugenics movement. Now, eugenics is still a conversation today. There are still people who believe in eugenics. And eugenics is kind of the idea of eradication. And it's very unfortunate that that was something that people really believed and still do believe. But the eugenic movement came out just before World War II and Nazism, but Nazism is probably the biggest example globally of eugenics and Nazi Germany's execution of disabled people along with other minority groups that were out in Eastern Europe, sorry. geography is not my forte. But anyway, so the idea of eugenics kind of arose in the early 1900s, and it quite literally was forced sterilization. So it was the idea that the human race gene pool needed to become more advanced, and disabled people were poisoning the gene pool by reproducing. So it wasn't at first straight up the like execution and murder and mass murder of disabled people. It was forced sterilization, forced lobotomization, and that happened a lot in the late 1800s and early 1900s. And it's kind of the idea that like we don't want disabled people like poisoning the gene pool. But as many people know, not every disability is genetic anyway. A lot of them are acquired. A lot of them are, their sources are still so vastly unknown. There's a lot of environmental factors that can cause disability. So obviously it didn't work. And it became a slightly more volatile model of what is now the medical model. And that's kind of where the medical model originated, was the idea that we needed to cure and fix them because we don't want, like, it's, they're the problem, not society. And this is the model that's kind of followed all the way up into the 90s and into even present day a lot. Moving on into in the 70s and the 60s and 70s. So with the civil rights movement really taking full swing, a lot of other minority groups took it as the, yeah, we're gonna fight back too. Because at the time, disabled people were not employed. There were still cases of institutionalization not happening. Up until the 70s, there were these things known as the ugly laws. And the ugly laws are basically, if you looked unsightly or like physically not normal, you were not allowed in a public place. And several states and cities actually had these in place where if you were in a wheelchair or if you had a physical deformity, you were not allowed to eat at a restaurant because you were unsightly for other people and other people shouldn't be forced to have to look at you. And kind of the idea that like that existed is still like, to me even. So I think the last one of those was repealed in the early 70s. So that's still quite recent that these were finally like getting rid of. So the 70s, we have what is known as the Rehabilitation Act and the Section 504. And this is where the 60s and 70s is where like hardcore activism and protesting really started to happen. So the Rehabilitation Act was kind of like the baby ADA. It was the baby version of, you know, starting to protect employment rights and protect equal access in public spheres. Public transit kind of came on a little after that. But one of those, so that was passed in 1973. And then one of the sections of it was called the Section 504. 504 is a pretty well-known title within disability because it the Section 504 protects a lot of things, even currently in education and public sphere and public accommodation. But because of how it was getting passed, they had to pass these regulations. So they passed the law. The law was in place, but the Section 504 thing was not actually getting regulated. So there were these sit-ins for several years called the Section 504 sit-in. And I think the longest one lasted up for, it was about a month that people were sitting in government buildings around the country and just like because they really were trying to fight very hard for this to be passed, and it wasn't getting passed for like 3 or 4 years. And this is where some of the biggest names in disability activism came up, such as Judy Heumann, who is probably one of my favorite people to listen to. I think Pastor himself has also listened to some of the talks from Judy. I think she's fantastic, and she's still a massive advocate. Her activism started in the 50s, and she still speaks today about it and her experiences. And she had polio, so now she is in a wheelchair, and she travels the country and still talks. And it's really fantastic that she still does that. But anyway, starting in the 80s, we had laws that started to protect public transit. In 1989, we had the first draft of what is the ADA, and there was a lot of different things that people were like, hey, we really need this law passed. You know, there was the civil rights law, the civil rights protections for African Americans at the time. And they were like, well, we want one of those too. So in 1989, the first version of the ADA was drafted, and it was kind of passed around. And because they were fearing at the time was the same thing that happened with Section 504, and it taking 4 or 5 years for it to actually happen, they did probably the most well-known portion of disability activism in the disability rights movement, which is the Capitol crawl. And kind of as a really major, like, hey, listen to us, we are here. People with disabilities literally got up out of their wheelchairs, they left their walkers behind, they left all their mobility aids behind, and they crawled up the stairs of the Capitol Hill to be like, hey, listen to us, we are here. And the Americans with Disabilities Act, which is the civil rights legislation that protects people with disabilities and is still in effect today and is a massive piece of public accommodation, both employment accommodation, education accommodation, public accommodation, all those things are protected under the Americans with Disabilities Act. And that was passed in July of 1990. So this coming summer, we're coming up on the 32nd anniversary of the passing of the civil rights legislation that actually protects people with disabilities. And some of the things that came out of the ADA are things that we deem normal now, like ramps and elevators and banked curbs so wheelchairs can get up and on the bubbles on your city curbside, so that people who have visual impairments can feel the edge of a curbside with their white cane, all the way up to education protections. The piece of legislation that protects my right to have Aster in a public, any place in public, is actually in the Americans with Disability Act as well. The Americans with Disability Act was revised in 2010, but it still holds up today as the major piece of disability rights protection. There are still a lot of things with the ADA that people are not super satisfied with, and that there's a lot of improvements we still want, and people are still trying to fight the ADA, and there's still a lot of accessibility issues and ableism still found in today's society. And it's really interesting to take a look at some of these topics, because people with disabilities are the largest minority group, and we're one of the more recent of to get civil rights protections, despite being making up about 25% of the American population, which is, I have a fire drill. I'm in my dorm room. Well, we're gonna go on an adventure, if that's okay, because I can't stay in here.
Do you want me to take a...
Yeah, if you want to take the reins for a few minutes, I got to go outside.
Sure thing. That's completely okay. I'm so sorry. wow. And I thought it's bad when, like, the dog barks, you know? That's a rough one. You know, I think a few things, friends. I know I talked about it in I think a couple sermons somewhat recently, but have y'all all watched Crip Camp yet? Pete has, Gene has Carly Rianne, have you watched it yet? In my mind, it tells the story that Hanna was lifting up so, so well, and in a really cool way. It kind of stars Judith Heumann, who Hanna was just talking about. I'm just going to show y'all the trailer of it, because the really cool thing, as a summer camp counselor, Hannah's a summer camp counselor too, the disability rights movement in the United States in some ways really got going at a small summer camp here in upstate New York. Plus it has some really sweet like 60s music, which I love. So I'm going to play that for y'all. And then, Hanna can continue navigating having a fire drill during a class.
Wait, you want me to tell them what happened? Well, two people got cramps and they're squinting.
We were all very hyper about it. And I have to go shower some people. See you later.
I wanted to be part of the world, but I didn't see anyone like me in it. I hear about a summer camp for the handicapped run by hippies. And somebody said you probably only smoke dope with the counselors, and I'm like, sign me up.
Up to Camp Jeanette and find yourself.
There I was at Woodstock.
You wouldn't be picked to be on the team back home, but at Jeanette, you had to go up the back.
Even when we were that young, we helped empower each other. It was allowing us to recognize that the status quo is not what it needed to be.
The world always wants us dead. We live with that reality.
At the time, so many kids just like me were being sent to institutions. It was just a continual struggle.
Most disabled people, like myself, are unable to use public transportation.
We needed a civil rights law of our own.
A rehabilitation program has been vetoed by the president because it was cost prohibitive.
We decided we were going to have a demonstration.
You get the call to action, to the barricades.
A small army of the handicapped have occupied this building for the past 11 days.
So many people from Camp Jeanette found their way into the building.
The FBI cut off the phones. The deaf people went, we know what to do. That's how we communicated to the people outside the building. The Black Panther Party would bring a hot meal. We were like this.
We are the strongest political force in this country.
We will no longer allow the government to oppress disabled individuals. And I would appreciate it if you would stop shaking your head in agreement when I don't think you understand what we are talking about.
What we saw at that camp was that our lives could be better.
If you don't demand what you believe in for yourself, you're not going to get it. I said
you like to see handicapped people depicted as people.
Excuse me?
So, yeah, it's a, if you haven't watched, it was one of the most inspiring and interesting, frankly, documentaries I have.
Can I just say, reading this book, I expected to be impressed by it, but I wasn't quite expected for how much of a badass you would be. Because you don't just advocate for human rights.
It didn't stop playing. It was Trevor Noah talking with Judith Human. Sorry about that. Hanna, do you need some more time? What's your deal?
It's not a drill, but I'm walking to a quiet location right now. This is really exciting. I'm assuming someone burnt popcorn or something. It happens all the time. But so sorry about that. That was really exciting.
All good. All good. I'll fill a few more minutes with one other video I had if you want me to.
Good?
You're good?
I think so.
Quiet.
Say hi, Aster.
Wow. Some of you watched Crip Camp. I don't know if it was the first time you had heard about Camp Jeanette, when I had mentioned it in a sermon, but I had until Rachel mentioned it to me, I had never heard of this before. And I'm like super into protesty things and civil rights movements and so on and so forth. And I think it just goes to show this is such a central civil rights issue in America. And it's one that has such little visibility. We all know Martin Luther King Jr. We all know Cesar Chavez, and these really incredible and they're so important folks and important movements. But for whatever reason, this issue where it is sort of the, as Hannah was saying, the largest kind of persecuted minority, it's sort of been an invisible movement, even though it's fundamentally changed. Every building we walk into, well, except for churches, so Hannah, I'll turn it back to you. Yeah.
Yeah, no, Pastor is really right. And I think that's why, I hope you guys can hear me. It is a little noisier out here. I think that's part of why I'm so like interested in the conversation, because I mean, at the time I didn't realize how much things like a handicap accessible stall made a difference, or how much a staircase made a difference, because I didn't need the accommodation. But like, then you realize how many people benefit from such an accommodation. Even as someone who doesn't use a wheelchair, I need to use a handicap accessible stall. One, my dog is 75 pounds. And two, I need handrails to balance myself. So it's just like those little things that people don't really think about. And it really has been a silent movement. And there's a lot of people even today, like in conversations that I've had, that like a public building being accessible isn't their problem, it's our problem. And I'm like, that's not quite, yeah, this still like, it makes 25%. That's one in four people. That's a lot of people. Like that's a very vast amount of the American population. And, you know, it's a really like fun joke that we have, like you can join the club any day. And most people at some point in their life do, because as you age, you require a lot of those public accommodations as well. And like, it's really interesting to have these conversations as someone who's 21 years old, and people are like, you know, you look fine. And I'm like, well, there's still a lot of stigma surrounding, you know, I'm too young to have a physical mobility impairment. I'm too young to use a walking cane. And there are people who are like, you know, you're so young. And I'm like, well, yeah, but that doesn't change the fact that I still have a physical impairment, and this cane helps me so much. And I actually used to be incredibly ashamed of using mobility aids in public, less so now. I'm getting a lot more confident with it, just because people are always like trying to converse with me because I'm too young to use a walking cane. Or, you know, what in the world is my dog for? And people always feel like, my story is their business, just because I don't fit their description of a disabled person. So it's a really interesting topic. Now people are listening to my conversation out here. But yeah.
Any, I didn't realize I was muted. Invite them in, Hannah, if you want, you know. We can have a few more folks at the conversation. that are listening. I would love for folks just to reflect a little bit about, you know, Hannah did a really quick overview of that story. Crip Camp provides a great overview, too. Did any of you know much about this stuff? Like, to me, I am... flabbergasted that I, until really trying to study this until recently, didn't know almost any of it.
I had an aunt, she's not alive anymore, who worked in one of those institutions. And several times she took me with her to see her clients. And I'll tell you, it was the most depressing place I've ever been. Very, very dark and dingy, and you know, people just laying in bed crying. It was so sad.
Yeah, and even some of that like reflects on today, and like the push for improvements in residential care centers, nursing homes, residential hospitalizations, such as psychiatric wings and things like that, and how people are being treated in these centers, and how it like being big advocates for CNAs and nursing homes to be treating people appropriately. There's still these battles happening all of the time, every single day, with residential care situations. Even though it's not the asylums that we had in the 1800s, there's still a lot of issues and abuse that happens in residential care centers today. Quiet, please. Quiet.
right, there's been a big debate in the last year, and of course the law didn't get passed, right, about, you know, supporting, you know, whether or not, you know, residential care folks are, you know, should be in some ways thought of as the type of, as a piece of our infrastructure to support everyone, right? And laws didn't pass, and therefore, you know, residential care workers are some of the least, I guess, kind of, you know, paid, and you know, there's such a critical, and for so many of our family members, they're, you know, some of the worst paid and worst treated workers in our society to this day, which in turn also leads to people, you know, people with disabilities not getting the right care they need. For sure. Yeah. And so
I think one of the saddest moments and yet the most uplifting moments was when Barb and I were visitation ministers, and we would go to Glendale and the various nursing homes. I mean, some of the residents look so sad, and just stopping by and saying hi and patting their shoulder, I mean, brought a smile to their face. It was really, and the workers worked, at least what we could see, worked really, really hard, but there wasn't enough of them to take care of all the residents. And to go into a TV room and just see wheelchair after wheelchair with people just sitting there, vegetating really, was very, very sad. And yet on the other side of it, you could go to an activity room and see some people really happy with what they were doing.
Yeah.
That was the closest I think I've come to any kind of disability involvement, was visiting the nursing homes.
And by the way, we were just having a great conversation last night at Care and Concern. So Sherry Lamb is our new Care and Concern chair, and we will be through what's called the Stephen Ministers program. We're going to be kind of reworking to really rebuild that program kind of post COVID, and it's so important, because there's a lot of folks who just over the last couple of years in our congregation, some of our, you know, longtime beloved members who just it's harder for them to get out of their homes nowadays. So thanks for lifting that up, Carly. And yeah, for sure. One thing I wanted, and I know, you know, these are both going to be subjects of further classes, but I think two things I'd love, Hanna, maybe in our last kind of, we want to try to, you know, usually wrap up around 8:20. I'd love, maybe you just want to briefly touch on a little bit is, I know there's a lot of sensitivity and a lot of change in like the language we use. And so I think as we're talking about this, even though we're going to talk about that more during the last class, like it might be good to give folks a little bit of an overview of that and kind of.
Yeah. Language is, even within the disability community itself, like I speak up on social media all the time. I have a lot of friends from very vast perspectives and very vast experiences living with disabilities around the world. Very, very cool to have some of these conversations with people. But like, even within the community itself, like the topic of language is still pretty like, you know, what's right, what's wrong, is there's no black and white. There's no like, yes, this is right, this is wrong. There is the yes, this is wrong. And yes, this is, you know, this is more correct, but there's still a lot of like gray area because of people have different opinions on it. But probably the most well-known conversation surrounding language is the idea of person first language versus identity first language. And I feel like it's really important when you're having these type of conversations to preface that these types of conversations like that we're having through this class are safe spaces, and like no one's gonna come at you with a cane for using the wrong terminology. Like my personal experience is I don't care person first would be autism is probably the most common example with this conversation. So person with autism versus autistic. Now within the autistic community, they generally prefer identity first language, because they don't want, like autism is a massive part of their lives. And it's not like kind of following that social model again, that like idea that like autism is not what's wrong with them. It's the fact that they are lacking accommodation. A lot of autistics prefer identity first. They prefer, I am an autistic. I'm not a person with autism. I am autistic. I personally don't care. I am disabled, I am a person with disability. Both of those, I feel like a lot of people prefer, you know, I'm just disabled. It's not a bad word to say the word disabled. Person with disability is also a correct terminology for such. Some people prefer it, some people don't care. I'm on the, I don't care. But there's obviously like a lot of language, your quite obvious ones, your R slur, which I don't ever feel appropriate to say, which is a kind of a push toward the idea that like disabled people were less, or they were slower, they weren't physically capable, they weren't mentally capable or intellectually capable at the time. That word is used most commonly with intellectual disabilities, and unfortunately it's kind of been strewn upon a lot of developmental disabilities as well. There's a lot of language with that. Crippled, it's a hit or miss. Generally it's not an acceptable word. A lot of times, like, I'll say it, I'm like, haha, I'm crippled, I'm too crippled for this. It's like kind of like learning how to reclaim your own language, which you see a lot with minority groups all around, like learning how to reclaim the language that people once used against us. But like, I don't like being referred to as someone who is crippled, because I'm not crippled. I'm a very physically capable person. I just have to do things a little differently. But like a lot of like things like that, and there's still like conversations on, well, is the word stupid or idiotic or dumb okay? And like a lot of these words are so normalized in our language, in our English language in America, that it's like, is it okay? Is it not okay? And like those conversations are happening all the time. I have conversations like that all the time with people. And like a lot of it, I don't feel like I'm allowed to speak on, or that I am qualified to speak on, because I do not live with an intellectual disability. But yeah, language is such an interesting topic. And then probably my favorite to talk about, and I had a really lovely conversations about euphemisms with Pastor a couple of weeks ago, or months ago maybe, but like learning how like euphemisms, which are words that are put in place of the word disabled, probably the most common ones are differently abled, or handicapable is an interesting one to me, or even like the idea that like your disability is your superpower, or the idea that you're a special needs. A lot of people do not like the word special needs. There are some people who are okay with it, and because it's a way to describe that they do need additional need, because our society doesn't normalize accessibility. Accessibility is not the norm in our society, so a lot of people deem accommodations as special needs, when a lot of people argue that they shouldn't be special, they're just needs. It's just really interesting conversations, and again, I could probably go forever on them, but like generally the push now from a lot of people is that disabled is not a dirty word. A lot of people like to skirt around it, and that's where those euphemisms came from, is the idea that, like, you know, the fear of disability, the stigma of disability kind of sourced these like words that, like, well, we don't want to put them down by saying they're disabled, when in fact it actually can skew a lot of the fight to push for accommodation if we're like skirting around the idea that people are actually disabled and they need things. So it's a very, very interesting conversation. Language, and I think we're gonna have another like whole class on modern and archaic language, and how to improve your language and how to be more mindful about your language. But yeah, language is it's a whole topic in its own, because it's so much gray area about what's acceptable and what's not, because a lot of people are afraid to ask what's acceptable to someone, because everyone has different preferences. And learning how to ask people their preferences is something that a lot of people are terrified to do, because of the whole concept of being politically correct all the time.
Any questions on this? Yeah, go ahead.
So how do the schools address the captioned special needs for the little kids, and how do the other students internalize that then?
Right, so this is actually a conversation I had with my former roommate, who's an education major, who's actually going into inclusive education. She wants to work with special education, and they do refer to it as special education or special needs children. And there's a lot of like, well, how are we teaching children to appreciate themselves, especially with children who have intellectual disabilities or what's the word? Oh, congenital physical impairments, such as myself. Because there are still a lot of schools that believe in the idea that teaching the disability separate from the person. And there's a lot of people who are like, well, you know, disability, like, it doesn't have to be your entire personality trait, but it's still a big part of your life. And it's not something you want to completely skirt around. Again, with the idea of the euphemisms. So schools, some of them have gotten a lot better. Some of them are still struggling. And there's really interesting conversations. I got to sit in a lecture last year of one of the education departments. They were like, oh, would you like to come and audit this conversation? And I was like, I'd love to come and listen. There's still a lot of things that are like, to me as a young adult who has been through high school, who has been now almost through college. And I'm like, well, that's a little bit icky to me. But there's still a lot of parents who want children to be raised the way the school systems are pushing it. But there is a lot now being a lot more push for reform in education, especially early childhood education toward disability empathy and how to prevent things such as bullying or prevent things such as self-esteem issues that may come from being someone who has a disability. You know, kids are kids, and it's really unfortunate that there's such a big bullying issue, especially in your early adolescence age. I mean, we're going through this with Kyle for the longest time, and even now a little bit, things have gotten better now that he is almost all the way through high school. So people his age are starting slowly to mature, slowly, but like all through his like middle school years, like there was so much like, you know, people are so mean just because they simply don't understand. So there definitely is a lot of room for improvement in education system, the public education system, toward language and disability. But yeah, generally the approach that they take now is more medical model, more the separation of the disability from the person. There are some that are shifting more for the social model, but there's still a lot of, yeah, it's generally referred to as like special needs or special education, especially when in reference to intellectual disability or developmental disabilities such as autism.
Yeah, that brings up the, I guess maybe the one other thing that maybe we could just get a little taste on, and we're also going to have, you know, more in-depth conversation about, but it would seem to me that my own experience as a pastor, and as a camp counselor too, by the way, mm-hmm. And I think the area where things are changing the quickest is related to folks with intellectual or developmental disabilities, right? I know I've seen the term, what's the term? The new term. Neuroatypical.
Oh, neurotypical versus neurodivergent.
Yes. Yeah. And also, you know, like when I was a camp counselor, you know, we had some training on autism versus Asperger's and sort of the spectrum idea, and that's all changing a lot.
Yeah. Oh yeah. The spectrum itself has changed a lot.
Yeah.
Years, because like Asperger's is no longer considered a diagnosis.
Right. Yeah. And I would say probably on a weekly basis, I am, you know, as I'm trying to steward a conversation and make sure everyone has an equal say, and as trying to figure out how to, you know, lead different events and so on and so forth, I feel like I know, like I know the right thing to do in terms of lots of other types of disability as a pastor. And I feel like there's lots of areas where, as we're working to be fully inclusive and fully welcoming, there's a lot still we need to change for all types of disability here at Messiah Lutheran Church. But I don't know, to me that just seems like the area where it's changing the most and is the hardest to sometimes know the best way to navigate. I don't know, Pete Jean, it sounds like that was a bit of you were lifting up too, but.
Yeah, I was thinking as Hannah was talking, just labeling someone or giving it a name is important. It's also important for a person with an intellectual disability It's important that they understand that they have an intellectual disability. It should be worked with a little more, like right up front. It shouldn't be something that we pretend, you know, okay, well, they learn slower than other people or whatever. I think they need to deal with their disability, so they need to know what it is. And we sort of made a mistake, I guess, with our son as he was growing up. We treated him just the way we would treat any child. And he grew up not knowing that he had a disability. And that really became a problem as an adult, because he thought that he was going to grow up and go to college and get married and have a family just like everybody else. And it still is difficult for him to understand that he has limitations. And I think that it's important for people with intellectual disabilities to be realistic about their limitations, because they do have limitations. So not to say that they can't strive to do things that they want to do, and they might overcome some of the disability, but they really do. It is important for them to understand that there may be limits to what they can do. I always explain it to them like, you know, I was a nurse, but I couldn't be an astronaut because I'm just not smart enough to be an astronaut. We all have things that we can do and things that we're not really capable of doing. And it's important for us to understand that, because I would not be applying to astronaut school or college or whatever. You know, I'm not going to take classes in astrophysics or anything like that, because it isn't realistic. And I think it's important to be realistic.
Thanks for that, sharing that, Jean. And it's a lot, you know, your own personal experience. Hanna, any, you know, kind of commentary on some of that?
Right. No, I totally agree with that. And I think this is kind of what I was kind of pushing for when I was trying to talk about school system. That's the belief, is the separation of the person from the disability. Like they treat them. And there's a lot of, like, within the school news, the concept of inspiration porn, which is a whole other concept. But that's like the inspiration porn is the idea that someone with a disability is inspirational just for existing. It's really annoying. People are like, oh my gosh, you're a full-time college student? I'm like, yeah, that's a pretty normal thing to go to college. I mean, obviously that's like not like the only option, but like kind of just like the idea that like we're inspirational just for existing. And you see this a lot with intellectual disability. And obviously intellectual disability is not my personal area of knowledge, because I don't know a ton of people who have what would actually be described as an intellectual disability. Obviously Kyle is autistic, my other brother Wyatt is also autistic, and that's considered a developmental disability. And the difference is, an intellectual disability is a disability that affects your IQ and like your ability to learn. And so like ADHD is not an intellectual disability. Down syndrome is an intellectual disability. Things like that. Autism is a developmental disability that affects social processing predominantly. But it's not, it does not affect their IQ, so it is not an intellectual disability. But a lot of them get grouped together a lot, especially autism, because it's kind of a lot of conversation around autism is kind of finally being talked about, and people are finally getting it very slowly. But like the idea of neurotypical versus neurodivergent, like Pastor had mentioned, is stemming from autism and ADHD, and the stigmas that are finally starting to get broken down around it. One person I highly recommend, I'm not going to bore you guys with her whole story, but Temple Grandin. I actually went and saw her speak a couple of years ago, being a woman in the agricultural industry. She is an autistic woman in the agricultural industry, and she actually revolutionized how cattle farms, the meat industry, handles cattle. And it's really interesting, and it's like now it's the most widely used practice around the country for meat industry. But anyway, kind of just like perpetuating the idea that like they're not stupid. But the idea of neurodivergent versus neurotypical, so someone who thinks normal, in quotations, because obviously in consideration of the social model of disability, they're neurotypical, but someone who may have their brain wired a little bit differently, can process information a little bit differently, would be considered neurodivergent. And neurodivergencies, common neurodivergencies are OCD, autism, ADHD, even things like, even some like schizophrenia, even some like mental health conditions are finally being pushed more toward this spectrum of neurodivergent versus neurotypical. And it's really interesting to finally see some of this unfold, because it's still very recent. Like the idea of like even the autism symbol changing from the puzzle piece to the infinity sign is still super recent. And that infinity sign is the symbol of neurodivergency. So it's been really cool to kind of see all of this unfold, because I have through social media a lot of friends who fall in that neurodivergent spectrum. And like obviously conversations we had about autism spectrum disorder forever and ever, just because I have involved myself so much with it my whole life, because I watched Kyle grow up. I was 3 when he was born, and I have seen it all unfold. Even once I left home to go to college, like I was still getting a lot of like seeing the changes and how things are getting treated and how that impacted him, and how it's really interesting. But yeah, no, I totally agree that it's really important to understand limitation, because I mean, even myself, and I don't have an intellectual disability, and my professor had to sit me down last semester and be like, no, you cannot do this class. It's dangerous for your body. Things like that, like learning to realize your limitations don't make you less of a person. I'm never gonna be a track runner. It's unrealistic in my life to even think about that anymore. Not that that's like a bad thing. It's just kind of like, I have a different path. I'm supposed to go down a different path, and there's lots of things that I can do and I can adapt to do. But yeah, learning how to understand limitations, especially when you're handling developmental disorders and intellectual disabilities, can be a really tricky thing, because you deal with the concept of infantilization, which is a big issue, especially in children with intellectual disability. Kind of like the idea that they're incapable of being able to think for themselves, and treating them like they can't think for themselves, and quite literally treating them like babies. And that's like, I've seen it. People like go up to talk to someone who is like 30 years old with Down syndrome, like they're a baby, like baby talking. Like I've seen it in front of my face, and I was like, wow, people actually genuinely do this to people. It's really eye-opening, because like a lot of things you're like, oh, people don't actually do that. It's just a concept. I asked her. But like, you see it actually happen. And then you're like, wow, people actually think and do and say these things to people, and they genuinely believe that they're in the right. So it's really, ableism itself is under the radar, and a lot of people don't realize that what they're doing is incredibly harmful to people in the long run. Maybe not in the short term, but in the long run, especially when you're talking about kids, and especially when we're talking about kids with intellectual disabilities.
Well, we should probably head towards wrapping up, but thank you. This was such a phenomenal intro, and thank you all for joining too. I thought the one way we could close out, I found this to be a, I don't think this is inspiration porn. There's a really 1 minute short interview, with, Jennifer Keelan, who was, the young 7-year-old girl who was really central to the Capitol crawl, in a short little interview with her as an adult, and I thought that might just...
That's not inspiration porn.
Cool.
She actually that was worthy of, like, being talked about. That's not inspiration. Inspiration porn is when, oh my gosh, you got up and brushed your teeth today. I'm so proud of you. You inspire me. That's inspiration
porn. Right. So, right, there's lots of things that I want to do the right way. Or yeah, so cool. I love that. And so I figured we could just close it out with that, because I just think, I mean, for me, it's just her, you know, at such a young age, her being so active in this movement, with that to me is a really cool thing. So I figured we could close out with that, and then we'll wrap. And everyone could hear when I did the Crip Camp trailer, people could hear that? Okay, cool.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember when we were trying to get the ADA passed, and I need to climb the steps. I want to climb the steps. And Wade said, go for it. So I got out of my wheelchair and I started climbing. Well, the next thing I know, I've got 50 cameras on me and I've got mics all over me, and it's like the hottest day, you know, the month of March. And I'm just, I mean, and I'm like, you know, I'm like 8, 9 years old, and I'm going, water, 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 I need water. And, you know, I've got the little pamphlet in the back of my pocket that we're supposed to hand over to the politicians to get the ADA passed. And they say that that it was the image of me climbing those steps that, you know, was the final decision to get the ADA passed. And, I mean, I had to do it.
All right, I want to do this in the right order. How do I?
Oh. I mean,
there. If I don't stop that first, then I'll just start playing another video. Okay, cool. Yeah, so, I mean, right? I'll take all night if I have to. To me, when I think of concepts of hope and liberation and freedom, and that, you know, is a very central part of our faith, that just voices that. The voice of the little 7-year-old girl is a really great example of that. So I'll close it with that. Next week, once again, we're going to have a deeper dive into the scriptures, both, once again, you know, sources of hope and liberation, as well as the ableism that is inherent in the scriptures. You heard a great example of that this past Sunday, right? Where it's this, in one level, really inspiring story of, right, Paul is blind and now he sees, right? And it's a helpful analogy in some ways, and it's also incredibly ableistic. And how do we net, right? I mean, think about this, I mean, the song Amazing Grace, I was blind, but now I see, right? Like, how do we deal with those sort of analogies and so on and so forth? So I'm really looking forward to that class. Hannah, thank you so much. And if you're watching this and you're not here live, reach out to me and I can make sure to get you a syllabus for this class that I'm going to write later tonight and tomorrow morning. So you will all get that, and you will all get it. I'll link this video afterwards as well. So thanks so much, and God bless.
Thank you.